Well, here we have a story that we've heard over and over again. It's a story that we've seen and we've read time and time again. And it's a story that starts out really good for the disciples and then ends kind of difficult for everybody, right? Peter has this great epiphany and calls Jesus the Messiah, the Son of the Living God. And then not 2 seconds later, Jesus is calling him Satan. All within probably 4 minutes here, we've got Peter making this announcement that Jesus is the Messiah. And then Jesus is turning around and calling Peter Satan. So what's going on here? What's happening in the text, and what can we learn from this to see what's going on? See, we want to look at this text and we want to think that Peter didn't get what was going on, right? Peter took Jesus aside when he started to teach these things because he didn't understand what Jesus was saying, even though it says in our text that Jesus said all of these things quite plainly, right? It says it right there in black and white, so obviously he said them to the point, and even we can read them. It says, I have to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to suffer. I'm going to be put on trial. I'm going to be mocked by the religious leaders. They're going to do bad things to me. They're going to kill me, and then 3 days later I'm going to rise. And Peter takes him aside, not because he didn't understand what Jesus was saying. I think Peter completely understood everything that Jesus had just said and got it and understood it, because Jesus said it plainly to them. And Peter understood it, and he took Jesus aside and said, this is not what the Messiah is supposed to be, right? None of us wants a Savior that goes and hangs himself on a cross and gets killed, because that's not what the Messiah is supposed to be. The Messiah is supposed to be like Superman and never die. The Messiah is someone who never would even think about giving up his life for other people because he never would have to. Right? Peter got it. Peter understood Jesus, and that's exactly where each and every one of us is at. I got one person shaking their head, which is good. I like that. But the thing of it is, we have to understand where this is all at. See, the best part of this text is not Peter saying that Jesus is the Messiah. It's not Jesus rebuking Peter and then calling the crowd in, right? The crowd had to be close enough that he could call them in with the disciples, because he rebuked Peter just in front of the disciples. And then he called the crowd in to come in and talk to him, and he told them that if you want to follow me, you have to what? Deny yourself, take up your cross, and come after me. If you deny me in the world, I'll deny you in front of the Father. See, that's the interesting part to this whole text. It starts out very innocuously, and it says, as they were walking through the region of Caesarea Philippi. Where is that? Does anybody know? I'll go get a map. Can you show me on a map where it's at? It's actually current day Banias. I honestly do not know how to pronounce this word, but it's Banias is the current modern day name of the town. See, I got people now that are Googling it, looking it up to find out where it's actually at. I can show you actually where it's at. If I had a map up here, I could show you where Caesarea Philippi is. And we just read across that, and we don't even bat an eye. We don't think about it. We just move on to Peter saying that Jesus is the Messiah, and then Jesus rebuking Peter for saying that the plan's not going to work, and then Jesus telling us to take up our cross. But we have to understand where Caesarea Philippi is. Because if I ask you right now, can you proclaim that Jesus is Lord, how easy is it for you within this crowd of people to say, yes, I believe that Jesus is Lord? How easy is that? It's pretty easy. Can we all say that? Jesus, 1, 2, 3,
Jesus is Lord.
There you go. See, now that was really simple and easy. We can do that here in this crowd because it's safe, right? Caesarea Philippi is a city that was built by Herod the Great and then expanded by Herod Philip, Herod's son, to a city to honor who? Caesarea is?
Caesar.
Thank you. Caesar. It's a city to honor the current Roman Caesar, the head of the Roman government. And the ancient town that they were in was the home of Baal worship. If you've ever read the Old Testament, you know that Baal was one of the prophets that many of God's prophets would speak against. This city of Caesarea Philippi was the home of Baal worship. And then it later became the home of the god Pan. If you don't know anything about the Greek god Pan, go look it up. Pan is the god of some very interesting stuff. And that's all I'm going to say here. So those of you that know are laughing and giggling and shaking your heads. So children, make sure your parents are with you if you're looking up the god Pan. Parents, there's your warning. Do not let your children look up the god Pan on their own. It was the home of Pan worship. This was the place where Greek gods and goddesses statues were, where they honored Caesar as a god and had a temple built for him where they would go and worship Caesar. This is the first public confession of Jesus being the Messiah in the Gospel of Mark. And it's not in the temple. And it's not in a house. And it's not in a safe place. It's out in public. It's at the Mall of America or Lambeau Field. How easy is it for you to say that Jesus is Lord out there? How easy is it for us to do proclamation of the gospel outside of these walls? That's exactly what Jesus is telling us we have to do this morning in this passage. Anyone who will take up their cross and follow me and go where I lead them. And we look at taking up our cross as a bearing of a burden. Again, it's not a bearing of a burden. It's a freeing into a life that God has for us. Bearing our cross of Christ is not a burden on our lives. It's opening our lives and freeing us to the very thing and to the very life that God has prepared for us. It's living out our God-created existence in the world, in the Mall of America, Lambeau Field, wherever you might be. That's what bearing your cross is. Understanding that God did what he did, that Jesus did what he did for you, so that you could have an abundant life. Last week I quoted the book Behind the Stained Glass Windows by John and Sylvia Ronsdale. I have another quote. They quoted a study by the National Council of Churches of Christ, who concluded, and here's the quote, "As people see it, the main thing blocking church support simply is a surpassing urge for more affluent living. Rival attractions seem to be gaining more of the religious dollar." End quote. See, the way we live our lives and the way that we project things out in the world is the way that people see who we follow. The way that we live our lives and the things that we seek after are the way that people see who we have as our God. I said week before, if you want to show me where your heart is, what did I say? Anybody remember? Show me your checkbook. And I'll show you mine. Actually, I will, because the last five checks I wrote were to St. John's. Because of the auction. But if you want to know where a person's heart is centered, that's what you look at. Where are you spending your money? What in the world is drawing your attention and focusing you on that? We've all seen the TV commercials, we've all seen the billboard ads, we've all seen the internet ads that want us to buy the products. And what of those things, like Jesus walking through the streets of Caesarea Philippi, what of those statues, what of those ads are calling you, pulling your attention away from where it needs to be? Because that's what God is calling us to focus completely and solely on Him. To have our focus so centered on Christ that we don't see all that other stuff and don't worry about it. We don't worry about what people are going to say. We don't worry about not having the things that we need. Because we have everything that we need in Jesus Christ. So how do we focus ourselves and pick up our cross, knowing that it's not a burden, but a freedom into a life that God has called us to, and live our lives in such a way that we don't look for the affluent lifestyle, but we look for that life that Jesus Christ has called us to follow Him and to go into the world, to not only say that Jesus is Lord here in this place, but that Jesus is Lord wherever we go, be that high school, middle school, elementary school, Walmart, the mall, Target, Fleet Farm, wherever you go, be able to say without hesitancy who you follow and who it is you live your life for. That's what God is calling us to. To be so unashamed of the gospel, to proclaim it loudly and proudly to all so that they might also come to see and to hear and to be affected and drawn into that life that God has given to them. So help us believe that we are following after Christ and that we can give everything up and self-sacrifice our lives for the cross of Christ so that everyone might know of His love for them.